Hello and welcome to Kaiju Masterclass 2. We are extremely pleased and honored to have award-winning director and screenwriter Kazuki Omori as our special guest. Mr. Omori is among the most influential contributors to the Heisei Godzilla series, having directed and written both Godzilla vs. Biollante and Godzilla vs. King Ghidorah. And his story and screenplay writing credits include both Godzilla vs. Mothra and Godzilla vs. Destoroyah. Mr. Omori first started making films when he was a medical student, and he was a member of the Directors Company, which was a consortium of independent young Japanese filmmakers in the 1980s. And he's made films not only in the giant monster and tokusatsu genre, but in a variety of different genres. Mr. Omori holds a degree in medicine, and he has taught at several universities, including Osaka University of Arts. And we want to welcome Mr. Omori. Thank you for being here. I'm Steve Reifel, of course, and here with Patrick Galvin. We'll be asking the questions, and our translator is Mariko Godzicheski. Thank you very, very much, Mariko, for your assistance here today. And Patrick, why don't you go ahead and start things off?
Okay. Mr. Omori, as Steve mentioned in the introduction, in addition to being a filmmaker, you are also a medical professional. You are a licensed doctor. So our first question is, when and why did you decide to pursue a career in film instead of medicine?
あの、選択するとか、そういうことじゃなくて、大学、医学の大学行く前、高校時代から映画が好きで、映画やってて、映画の方に進みたいというのもあったんですけど、ファーザーが、父親が、医者だって、大体医者の家だったんで、まあ、医学部行くかなというぐらいのことで行ったんですが、まあ、行ってから、要するに、家が、医者だった、ドクターだったということだけですね。
Okay. All right. So he said that he was always interested in the movie. His family was basically the doctor. So it wasn't actually his will that he went to a medical school, that he just did one of the family thing.But he was originally more interested in the movie.
日本の医学の大学は6年間行くことになってるんですが、僕はいろいろ映画を作ったりなんかしてたんで、8年間結局行って卒業しました。
So, Japanese medical school is basically the 6-year program.But because he was, during the school time, that he was already making films. So that the years that he stayed in the medical school turned out to be 8 years instead of 6.
卒業した時に、ヒポクラテスたちという医学生の青春を描いた映画を作ってそれが評価されて、まあ、この道に入ったんです。で、まあ、もう40年ぐらい前の話になるんですけど、まあ、そういう意味では、医学部に8年行って、その映画1本撮るためだったなと、今は考えてます。
When, right after he graduated from the medical school, that he made a film called, what is it?
The English title is Disciple of Hippocrates.
Okay. That movie, and that was about the medical school students. Mm-hmm. That movie was graded very high. That was how that he actually turned into a movie world, the filming world, instead of a medical field.
まあ、その時の、学習したことの一部は、ゴジラ VS ビオランテなんかにも少しは役に立ってるんじゃないかなと思ってます。
And that he thinks that what he did in that movie was actually that they used for making Godzilla versus Biollante.
Interesting.
ですからあのどっかで医者じゃなくて映画監督になろうと決めた瞬間があったわけじゃなくて、なんかやってるうちに映画の世界に入ってきたというのが正直な。ちなみにあの医者は卒業後一日もやっていません。
So, it wasn't like he had a one day that he just decided to be the filmmaker. It just turned out to be that way when during the school time and throughout making films.
Okay.
まあ世界のフィルムメーカーの中でも医者で映画監督っていう方は何人かいらっしゃるんじゃないですか。
Yeah, he thinks that he's not the only one who has a medical degree and also that the film director.
Interesting. Can Mr. Omori, can you tell us what filmmakers or writers have been your primary influences as a director and a screenwriter?
高校時代、ここに書かれているように、ジャン・リュック・ゴダールの映画なんかを見て、ああ、これだったら自分でも撮れると思って映画を撮り出したんですけれど、そんなに、ゴダールの影響を受けてませんね。アート系の映画よりも、いわゆるエンターテインメントの映画の方が、好きで、ゴダールよりはクロード・ルルーシュそれからフィリップ・ドブロカとかそういうエンターテインメント系の映画の方が好きで、そっちの方の影響を強く受けてます。
ジャン・ルカ・ゴダール、
Jean-Luc Godard.
Okay. He watched that, his movie when he was in high school. He kind of thought that, well, if he can make something like that, and then that's how he decided to try that way for the first time. But he doesn't think that he was completely influenced by his style, because what he was interested was more in the entertainment type of film instead of the artistic kind.
アメリカの監督で言うと、ジョン・スタージス、グレート・エスケープ、マグニフィセント・セブン、ジョン・フランケンハイマー。
Mm-hmm. Those are the American directors that...
Yes.
Brian...デパルマ、
ライデパルマ、mm-hmm.
まあそういう系統の映画が好きでした。影響を受けてます。特にジョン・フランケンハイマーはやっぱりアメリカで一番の監督だと思ってます。
Yes, he thinks that John Frankenheimer, he thinks is the best movie director in the United States.
Oh, interesting. Any particular film? Frankenheimer's done a lot, that's for sure.
Train. Grand Prix.
Grand Prix.
Yeah. 今でも年に何度かフランケンハイマーの映画は DVD で見てみます。
He still watches his movie on DVD, still till this day.
もともとそういう意味ではヨーロッパのアート系の映画よりもアメリカのエンターテインメント映画の方が好きです。
So he likes more that the American entertainmenta type of movie more than the European artistic movie.
Interesting.
そもそも 小さい頃に父親に連れて見に行ったあのザ・ロンゲスト・デイ、ザ・ロンゲスト・デイで私はあの映画に目覚めた。映画ってこんなすごいんだと思ったのはそれです。
So the first the step that、he was interested in that movie world was that the longest day that his father took him to see when he was a little child.
その後にグレートエスケープ、グレートエスケープ。でも、ムービーフリークになった。
And then that's how he turned out to be a movie freak.
Well, he grew up in the 1960s, that was a wonderful, a lot of people dismiss that decade, but it's a wonderful decade for movies, I believe. Mm-hmm. Patrick, I think you're up next.
Sure. Mr. Omori, your film background is quite different from previous Godzilla directors. How were you chosen to direct Godzilla vs. Biollante, and why did you want to make this film?
ゴジラ映画を作ってるのはあの東宝っていう会社ですけど、そこでもプロデューサーの友幸田中があのゴジラ映画のリーダーだったんです。その友幸田中があの新しいゴジラ映画を探している中で、この監督がいいんじゃないかと思って、僕に来たんですけれど、多分今言ったような友幸田中の好きな映画も僕の好きな映画と近かったからじゃないかなと思ってます。
The producer, Tomoyuki Tanaka, he was the one that the, who picked him as a, the director of this movie. Back then, that he was looking for someone new.And then back then, he thinks personally that probably because that they had in common of what type of a movie that liked.
あの、友幸田中が目指したのは、日本映画風じゃなくてアメリカ映画に近いゴジラ映画を目指してたみたいですね、当時。
And, especially that the Tomoyuki Tanaka, what he was looking for that movie, the Godzilla vs. Biollante, was that he wanted to make it more like an American movie instead of the Japanese Godzilla movie.
だから今言ったようなアメリカのエンターテインメント映画が好きで、それで育ってきた僕は。
He grew up watching the American movie, and then the, also that the Tomoyuki Tanaka liked the same type of movie that he liked. And then so that's how that Tanaka thought that he might be the good choice for what he was looking for back then.
だからビオランテを作るときに友幸田中が言ってたのは、エイリアン2ジェームス・キャメロンエイリアンズああいうゴジラ映画ができないかというおっしゃってました言ってました
Tanaka was the one that actually mentioned about that the aliens that he wanted to make the Godzilla movie kind of like alienMovie.
エイリアン2みたいな映画っていうんで僕も、それならっていうんでさっき言ったようないよいよ自分もそういうアメリカンエンターテインメントの映画が撮れるなとすごく意気込んでやりました。
So because he mentioned about aliens and he was really excited about that there, you know, that this time that he could finally get to make some type of an entertainment movie, just like Americans.
Oh, okay. Godzilla vs. Biollante is based on a story by writer Shinichiro Kobayashi. Mr. Omori, can you tell us about the process of turning Mr. Kobayashi's story into a screenplay and what ideas you introduced into the script?
やるにあたって、友一田中から、ゴジラ映画の、ストーリーを全国から募集してて、最終的に残った5つのストーリーを渡されて、どれが面白いと思うって聞かれたのが最初です。
で、Tomoyuki Tanaka was what do you call like a contest or the story contest type of thing, and he gave the Tomoyuki Tanaka gave him the last five stories, and then just asked him that which one he thinks it's most interesting.
Okay.
その中の一つに小林、ミスター小林のビオランテがあって、で、他にも、ゴジラと、ロボット軍団とか、それからもう一つあったのがゴジラ細胞をめぐって世界の国々が取り合いになるっていうお話とかがありました。
One of them was Shinichiro Kobayashi's movie, the story, and then the other ones are the Godzilla versus a robot army.Type of thing, and there was another thing was about the Godzilla cell that they're and that different countries are fighting for that.
Okay. で、Kobayashi, Mr. Kobayashi のストーリーは、植物の細胞とゴジラの細胞が融合して植物の怪獣ができるっていう話だったんです。
Kobayashi's story was about that the mixture of Godzilla cell and the plant cell turn into a plant monster.
だからそこに、ゴジラ細胞を世界の国々が取り合いするっていうお話を、くっつけて、膨らましていった。
Since someone else that had an idea of the different countries were fighting for Godzilla cells, and then so he just decided to put that into Kobayashi's story.
Oh.
And then that's how he started developing more.
Interesting.
The Sayagasa Mickey was Mr. Kobayashi's story. Oh. Sayagasa Mickey.
So, Miki Sayagusa was already in Kobayashi's story.
で、サラジアエージェントは、ゴジラ細胞のストーリーの中に確かあったような気がします。で、僕が作ったのは、自衛隊、ミスター・ゴンドと、黒木は私がストーリーで作った。
Okay. And so, the Saradia agent, that one was in the other story, and then so he just combined it. And what the Mr. Omori made was those self defense force,
Kuroki and Gondo.
And then Gondo and Kuroki. Those two he made.
Nice.
Okay, Mr. Omori, you mentioned the character of Miki Sayagusa, who is one of the most endearing human characters in recent Godzilla films of the last 30 or so years. Why did this particular type of character appeal to you?
Sayagusa Miki が超能力、スーパーパワー思ってるという設定はあったんですが、それを膨らませるのは、スティーブン・キングの、キャリー。
キャリー、yes.
あたりを参考にして、膨らましていきました。スティーブン・キングの影響ですね。
Miki Sayagusa's psychic power was already in original Kobayashi's original story, and then but when he started developing that, he learned more from Stephen King's story.
そうやってアメリカのエンターテインメントの要素を入れていったんですね。
So that's another thing that he wanted to make more like American, the movie.
The next question would be regarding Dr. Shiragami, another interesting character. Was there a special inspiration for this character? And did you think about any comparisons between his reckless science and the character of Dr. Sarazawa in the first Godzilla film?
まあ、ゴジラ映画に必要なエレメントは必ずあるマッドサイエンティストっていうのが必ずゴジラ映画には出てくるんです。まあ初代はセリザー、ドクターセリザーだったんですけど、まあゴジラ映画の脚本を作るにあたってどういうふうなマッドサイエンティストがこのまあ当時20世紀だといいのかなというあんまりにも変な人だとおかしいんで、その辺をこうリアルさとまあ科学の先端と入った科学者っていうのを設定をしましたね。
It's almost like a necessity to get the mad scientist character into Godzilla movie.And then so, this time that the, what he? That was my dog. what he thought was, for the newer generation that new, as a, in a new movie, what type of a mad scientist, fit to this movie? And then that's how, came up with that.Dr. Shiragami character.
まああんまりにもコミカルにならないように、現実に即した科学者っていうのには気をつけましたね。
He wanted to make it more realistic type of character. He didn't want to make it too comical. And then so that's one thing that he was really careful.
Mr. Omori, your next Godzilla film was Godzilla vs. King Ghidorah. This film has produced a lot of interesting discussions about its story. Some people have read it as kind of like a reaction to international criticism Japan received at the time for its trade policies and overseas investments. What was your view of Japan's situation at the time you made this film? And does your film say anything about the bubble economy and capitalism?
まあ、ビオランテの後に、ミスター田中、智之田中がもう一本っていうので、やったのがゴジラ、キングギドラですけれど、ビオランテよりももっとファンタジックに、ものをやろうというんで、タイムスリップを使ったストーリーにしたんです。今度はエイリアンズから、バックトゥザフューチャーに行ったわけですね。でその中で当時日本がすごく経済的に世界に進出していってまあアメリカのいろいろ土地を買ったり会社を買い取ったりねショッピングセンターを買い取ったりして日本がどんどんどんどん経済的に進行してる時代だったので、そこをストーリーに取り入れた。
Tomoyuki Tanaka, after Violante, he wanted to make another one, but so he brought up King Ghidorah, but this time he wanted to make it fantasy. So instead of the aliens, this time that he wanted to make it like the time slip type of thing, like Back to the Future.
質問に書いてある通り、日本が受けていた経済的なことから国際的な批判を受けてた影響がストーリーになってるということは書かれている通りです。
Back then, that the, because of a bubble economy, that the, Japan was going overseas and buying up all those American company and then the, you know all those things that the, he because you know because it was that time was happening so he actually wanted to put that what's happening at the back then into the story. And then that's how he made it that way.
まあ、あの21世紀になって経済大国になってたかっていうのはちょっと私の予想が外れたように思います。
If he said that Japan's gonna be such a big country that in the future, he doesn't think that's really it's gonna happen.
Next question is why in the same film did you change and update Godzilla's origin story very interestingly and link it directly to World War II and to the Japanese military? And second part of that question is was this change from the original origin of Godzilla considered at all controversial?
これはもともとゴジラはあの まあ太平洋の島でアメリカの核実験の影響を受けて怪獣になったっていうのはゴジラのストーリーにあるわけで、そこのところのあのじゃあその島にゴジラの元の恐竜がいたら戦争中はどうだったんだろうっていう、まあ、想像で、ああいうゴジラザウルスのシーンを考えたんですが。
Because of the nuclear experiment, he thought of if there was a dinosaur type of a creature and in the wartime, what's going to happen? And that's what he just came up with that.Type of idea.
それとさっき言ったように一番最初に見た映画がザ・ロンゲスト・デイだったんで一度そういう戦争シーンをディレクションしてみたいというのがあったんだと思います。
And because what he saw, the first movie that he saw was The Longest Day. And then soThat's another thing that someday that he was always thinking that there someday that he wanted to direct that type of the war movie.
Oh, okay.
スケールは全然違いますけど、スケールは全然ミニマムです。
Well, not the same scale, but still.
He may have already answered this, but was there any controversy about that particular change?
ゴジラの方はだいたいそれでも、ゴジラのオリジナルのストーリーに従ってそこを想像であったんで変えてないと思うんだけれど、キングギドラの方が逆にああいうふうにして、核実験で出てきたっていうのはかなりあのブーイングがありました。なぜならあのキングギドラ宇宙怪獣ということがオリジナルの設定なんで、核実験であんなキングギドラ出てきたっていうのはおかしいじゃないかというのは随分言われました。
Even he changed that the setup of origin of Godzilla, the concept itself that he didn't change. So Godzilla part didn't getany negative
feedback.
But in the other hand, that the King Ghidra, that's the one that he completely changed because he made it into the King Ghidra also related to a nuclear bomb instead of that the King Ghidra originally supposed to be that the space monster.
Right.
And then so he said that he's got a lot of booing.You know, for King Ghidorah instead.
Mm. Godzilla vs. King Ghidorah has been interpreted in a lot of interesting ways, especially here in the United States. When the film was fairly new, there was a publication here called The Wall Street Journal, which interpreted it as an anti-American film, and there were other U.S. outlets that felt the same way. How do you feel about this interpretation about Godzilla vs. King Ghidorah, and do you have a response to that?
これをちょっと読んでびっくりしたんですけど、アメリカ的だという批判があったんですか、実際に。
Well, he didn't know anything about that the Wall Street Journal wrote. So right now that he was actually surprised that there was such a idea of, that
yeah,
anti-American.
私は だけアメリカ映画を愛してるのに残念です。
And he loves American movies, so he is actually that very disappointed about to hear that.
It was on the front page.
Yeah. あの当時はあのウォールストリートジャーナルのあのもう最初のページにそういう記事が載ってたそうです。
いやどっちかというとこう日本の経済の暴走をアメリカが止めるっていう感じだとは思ったんですけどね。未来から来たのがアメリカ人で、それがキングギドラを使って日本を破壊しようとしたっていうところがちょっと、アメリカが日本を壊そうとしてるいうふうに捉えたのかな。
He didn't mean to make Americans as a villains or anything. Actually, the other way around, that because that Japan was getting so big that he actually meant to make American more like a hero type of a thing that they were trying to stop that Japan.Just kind of dictating the world that way in the future. Hmm. And then so.
Oh, very interesting.
What he meant to create in that movie actually was the opposite from what the American papers that wrote.
Interesting. Another interesting character that you've created is the character of Mr. Shindo.In the same film, we were wondering if you could describe your description of the relationship between Godzilla and Mr. Shindo. And we'd also interested to know if the part of Shindo was created specifically for actor Yoshio Tsuchiya.
まあ、ゴジラのドラマっていうのは、まあ、人間は人間のドラマ、怪獣は怪獣のドラマで、結構別々になってたんですけれど、一度怪獣と人間っていうところにドラマができないだろうかっていうのを、スペシャルエフェクトの川北浩一川北監督と相談して、人間とそれから怪獣が最後顔を合わせて見つめ合って涙を流すみたいなシーンはできないかっていうのをが最初でした。で、そういう設定を持っていくために、太平洋戦争での神道と恐竜のお話があって、それが何十年後かに出会うっていう設定を考えたんですね。
A Godzilla movie was always about, had a completely different drama. The monster, the kaiju was always with the kaiju, that people had a people side of the story. And so he wanted to, once that they combine that the kaiju part and the people part. And then so he actually talked to special effect director about that if,they can make something that people with monster together and something like that the people and the some that the people and the kaiju just kind of like looking at each other and then so that's how that the Godzilla sort of scene as a setup toward the future last scene with theThe Godzilla and the Shindo was that type of scene that he wanted to create as the human and the Godzilla like together.
You're talking about the scene where Godzilla kills Mr. Shindo. Why Godzilla kills Shindo in his words, in Mr. Omori's words, and whether or not this is actually a comment on the situation.In Japan at the time, Mr. Shindo seems to be a representation of the massive and rapid economic growth in the post-war period.
だから、 戦争中、太平洋の島で、神道とダイナザウルスとの間に生まれた友情が40年後、ダイナザウルスは、核実験によってゴジラになってしまって、で、神道さんは日本の中で、まあ、ある種、エコノミックダイナザウルスになっちゃったわけですよね。で、それを、要するに、まあ、ゴジラは、最後許さなかったということなのかな、今思うと。ミスター神道が、要するに、エコノミック、
はいはい、
ダイナザウルスになっちゃって、日本から世界にこう、経済で侵略していこうとしていく、そういう姿が、ゴジラが許せなかった。
Okay.
難しい
な。まあ、so in the wartime scene that what he wanted to make was sort of like the friendship between Shindo and the Godzilla Soros as a dinosaur.And then 40 years later, that the Godzilla turned into, that dinosaur, the Godzillasaurus turned into Godzilla because of the nuclear experiment. And on the other hand, that Shindo turned into that the economical dinosaur.And then, so that is, and the, he was the one that they're trying to invade all those world when he was an economic, and then the, so that is that the Godzilla could not that accept, and then that's why that the Godzilla.The reason that the Godzilla killed Shindo.
Interesting. Thank you.
Really quickly, Mr. Omori, to reiterate one quick question. Was the part of Mr. Shindo written with Yoshio Tsuchiya in mind to play it?
もう Tsuchiya さんは、Mr. Tsuchiya は、私がちっちゃい頃から見てたゴジラ映画の中では何度も出てきてらっしゃる、まあそういう映画がご本人も好きみたいですね。 だからすごいそういう特撮映画の土屋さんというのに私はすごいリスペクトがあったんで、ぜひこの役はもう土屋さんでやっていただきたいというのがありました。
So Mr. Tsuchiya was always in the Godzilla movie that he watched since when he was a child. And in his mind that Mr. Tsuchiya was always, he has to be in the science fiction or a Godzilla movie. And he has a big respect to him. And so he just couldn't think of anyone else.To play that role.
逆に私があのキャストで土屋さんって言った時に、東宝の方はもっと新しい人がいいんじゃないって言われて、いやもうこれは絶対土屋さんですとかなり強く言って、土屋さんのキャスティングになりました。
Actually that TOFO and TOHO the company thought that it should be someone newerThat the different the actor and but the Mr. Omori just could not accept anyone else but him, so he pretty much strongly pushed through to get him. Mr. Tsuchiya was already that the old star, not quite popular already that time.
Hmm. Well, it's a remarkable performance, and that final scene with him and Shindo, Godzilla and Shindo, is rightfully very remembered as one of the great scenes in all the Godzilla movies. Mr. Omori, in making Godzilla vs. Biollante and Godzilla vs. King Ghidorah, you also worked with a special effects team in order to make those films possible. Could you describe working with a special effects team on those two Godzilla movies?
Special effect director, Koichi Kawakita, と和樹大森がいるんですけれど、これは要するに監督がやりたいことを特撮監督に、一方的に言うんじゃなくて、僕の場合は特撮監督の川北浩一監督も何かやりたいことがあって、どういうことをやりたいんですかっていうのを話してるうちに分かってきて、でどっちかというと川北監督の方も僕のやりたいことをやってっていう、まあお互いにやりたいことを話し合ってそこで作っていったんですよ。だからどちらか一方的にこうやりたいかお前やれっていうことじゃなくて、そこは非常にうまくいったんじゃないかなと思ってます。
They both had the ideas that of what they wanted to do. And then so they talked to each other and they proceeded with the settlement about what they actually decided.
だから2人がいて、まあいろいろ意見を言い合って、じゃあおま、ま、任せました、任せましたがあって、最終的には僕は編集してまとめるっていうのは監督だったと思います。要するに2人が対立することなく意見交換しながら僕がまとめていくっていうシステムがうまくいったんじゃないかなと思いますけどね。
The last editing was done by Mr. Omori.
要するにね、喧嘩することなく仲良くやったということです。
Okay, well, so he's just saying that they didn't fight or anything, that they just talked to each other and then they just went along about just respect to each other and then just
だからもう光一川北はもう亡くなった、死んじゃったから、今ゴジラ映画をやれって言われても、もう川北さんがいないゴジラ映画っていうのは僕の中ではちょっと考えられないですね。
They think they got along really good, and then so he, the Mr. Kokita already passed away, and then so if he get to make another Godzilla movie again, that there actually he can think of another one that without the Mr. Kokita.
Both Godzilla vs. King Ghidorah and Godzilla vs. Mothra, which you wrote, have scenes and characters similar to Hollywood movies like Terminator, Aliens, and Raiders of the Lost Ark. We've talked about your love of Hollywood films. You've been discussing that, but can you talk about why you wanted to include those types of tributes in your movies?
もともと、じゃあ僕はなんで映画監督やってるかっていうと、そういうことがやりたいから映画監督をやってるんですよね。映画を見て、ああ、あんなシーンを撮りたいな、ああいうことをやってみたいなっていう、まあ映画に対する私の憧れが、自分が映画を作ることの、力になっている。そういう意味ではあんまりクリエイティブな監督じゃないかなと自分では思ってます。
He got to be a director because he wanted to make that type of thing. And then so, he just, throw that kind of scene into his own movie because that's what he wanted to do, and that's for his fun. Saying that he probably he wasn't completely a most creative type of director, but he was just having fun by himself.
そういう意味では最近のアメリカ映画でこれやってみたいなっていう映画はもうほとんどなくなりましたね。
Watching that the latest the American movies, that there's nothing that he wants to that make create anymore. Not like back then, lately.
スピルバーグ、ルーカス、キャメロン、それからコッポラ、そういう監督がいてるのアメリカ映画があったときは一番自分としては映画監督の夢がありましたね。
And so, that was when he had a biggest dream that when the American big names are used to be the Lucas, Spielberg and Coppola and then what's the last one? The Cameron, okay. The Cameron.
マーベルの映画見ても全然やりたいと思わない。
Well, he's not really interested in the Marvel movies.
The Marvel movies.
Mr. Omori, after Godzilla vs. King Ghidorah, you wrote the screenplays for two more Godzilla films, Godzilla vs. Mothra and Godzilla vs. Destoroyah. Both of these films were directed by Takao Okawara. When you were writing the screenplays, did you have creative freedom in writing the scripts, or did you receive input from the studio as well as Mr. Okawara?
もうゴジラ映画をやると、1年はもうゴジラずっとやらないといけないことになっちゃって、まあその頃は自分は他の映画も撮りたかったけど、もちろんゴジラもやりたかったけれど、1年間ずっとゴジラばっかりやってたっていうんで、脚本なら、まあ、1、2ヶ月、1年のうち費やしたら、まあ、参加できると思って脚本の方に回るんです。
He only had to work in a Godzilla movie for a whole entire year. And when he actually wanted to work on something else too. And then, but he just decided to do something else with the screenplay that in the writing that he just could do something else.
Godzilla Mothra はビオランテでエイリアンズ、それでキングギドラでバックトゥーザフューチャーやったんで、モスラは、インディージョーンズで行こうというんで、まあそういうトレジャーハンターみたいなのを主人公にして、まあ作ったんですけど、意外にインディージョーンズとゴジラ難しかったですね、という。
And so that's how he just he put into all those different scenes that he wanted to something else that he wanted to do into Godzilla movie, and then the what was the Mothra was Indiana Jones. Okay, that was actually much harder than he thought.
で、デストロイヤーは、ゴジラの、まあ、ある意味で最終作だったんで、一本目のゴジラのストーリーをちゃんと完結させようというんで、まあ、高知桃子さん、それから山根博士、それから芹沢博士、芹沢山根という、初代ゴジラのキャラクターを完結させようという、まあ、それは面白かったですけどね、脚本を作ってるときに、そういう話にしたかったんですけどね、1本目の初代ゴジラ映画を、なんか我々の手で完結させようという意図でやりました。
When he was working on Godzilla vs. Destoroyah,He wanted to conclude the original Godzilla story. And then so that's how that there he brought back all those original characters such as Yamane Serizawa. Mm-hmm. That's how he wanted to make that movie into that there that's just the conclusion of the first the Godzilla movie. That was fun, he said.
Yeah. Godzilla versus Destoroyah also brings back the Oxygen Destroyer, and as he said, it really dovetails it with the original film. It concludes the story. So as the writer of such a significant project, did Mr. Omori, did you feel any additional responsibility or pressure or any other kind of burdens as the writer of this particular film?
まあ、責任と言えるかどうかわからないんですけれど、核の問題はゴジラがアメリカの核実験によって生まれた怪獣だっていうコンセプトがずっとあって、要するに核爆弾とかそっちの方の恐怖に対する、メッセージだったんですけど、それ以降、核っていうのは原子力発電所の、まあ、日本の福島の問題ですよね。核汚染とか核爆発っていうの、核問題っていうのが、要するに、核実験じゃなくて、原子力発電所の、要するに日本国内で核の問題が起こってくるようになって、日本が要するに、まあ早い話、核汚染を、日本で起こっちゃうっていう、まあ海外の太平洋の島で核実験が起こって、核汚染が起こるんじゃなくて、もう日本の国内で起こってくるっていう意味で、まあ新たな局面になってるんじゃないかなと思いますが。
Originally, that their Godzilla story was about the monster created by nuclear bomb experiment by somewhere else on the Earth, not in Japan, but there. Later, in an actual world, that their Japan because of a nuclear power plant and that kind of thing, that not just somewhere else on the Earth, that Japan kind of like start creating a nuclear pollution in the country by itself. And he's not really saying about that though. If it's a responsibility type of thing, probably not, but that was something that put a new point that he wanted to bring up.
Was it, if I could, is there anything significant about the location of Hong Kong in the beginning of the movie?
最初の、香港っていうのは、
まだね、あの時、当時、今まあまあアメリカのゴジラ映画が出てきてあれだったんですけど、海外にゴジラが現れるっていうことがなかったんですよ。で、まあ、手始めに一番近い香港からっていうんで、香港に出てきたんですけど、ゴジラがアメリカ本土に現れるのは、アメリカでゴジラ映画が作られるようになるまで結局なかったんですね。だから、まあ、そういう意味で、最初の海外に現れたゴジラ、どこがいいかなっていうんで、まあロケーションの関係もあって香港が面白いんじゃないかなっていうんで、香港が出てきたんですけどね。
The reason that was Hong Kong was up till that the American the TriStar Godzilla shows up, but there was always Godzilla was always in Japan, and then the Godzilla never appeared in different country, and the Japanese production Godzilla just wanted to make a Godzilla appears in somewhere else, not just Japan. And including the considering about the location type of thing too. And then when they're talking about where is where to start, and that that's how that they just decided to pick Hong Kong. Because that's where that they can make a location too, and there somewhere outside of just to start out with somewhere outside of Japan that Godzilla's showing up. That's why they picked Hong Kong.
Thank you for that. I know that wasn't part of the plan, but I appreciate it.
No problem.
Thank you.
Mr. Omori, you've had a pretty long career in cinema. You've made a large number of movies. When you look back over the course of your career, how has the film industry in Japan changed?
17番.
はい、そうです。
ああ。日本の映画業界というだけじゃなくて、世界の映画がもう21世紀から変わったような気がします。で、一番はやっぱり、映画がフィルムからデジタルになったっていうことが一番大きいと思います。で、デジタルになって、特撮じゃなくて CG になってきて、ゴジラ映画も。僕は、なんだろうな、やっぱり怪獣映画っていうのは、スーツを着て人間が動くのがやっぱ面白いんじゃないかなと、思いますが、どうでしょうか?
It is not just Japan, actually, that the movie all over the world is completely changed, and then especially after going into a 21st century. And now that, they don't use film anymore even, and then it got to be a digital, and instead of monster suits, everything is done by computer graphics, and so that's that's the biggest technical change that they're all over the world was having. But personally, that they're he thinks that they're that monster movies more interesting if when it's a suit mation and someone actually inside of a monster, and then someone moves the monster
instead of
computer graphics.
スーツアクターが入って動くから、あの動きの何あの限界がある動きの制約があるわけですね。こういう、これ以上の動きはできないって、やっぱりスーツアクター、人間が入ってるから、怪獣の動きっていうのは制限される。で、それがコンピューターグラフィックスになると、もう何でもできちゃうわけですよ。飛んだり跳ねたり、走ったり。だから CG って本当何でもできるようになったから、逆に怪獣らしく見えなくなってきた。じゃないかな。最近のアメリカのレジェンダリーのゴジラ映画見てると、こんなにも怪獣がね自由自在に動けたら逆に面白くないなっていう感じは僕はします。
When the suit mation and then someone's inside of a suit, and that there is a limit about what they can do, how they can moveBut instead, that now everything's done by computer graphics, and there's no limit completely. And then that he thinks the limit actually created more that the realistic monster-like movement. And when the computer graphics just can, the monster can do anything. It's just jumping and flying and all that, moving fast and all over, moving all over and thing. And that to him, it actually is, seems like less realistic.
例えばキングギドラの3本の首っていうのは特撮であるとみんな 総演っていうんですか、つってやってるんですよね。ただそれが CG になるともう3本の首が自由自在に動いちゃって、あんな動きを逆におかしいなと僕は思いましたけどね。
And then, so like King Ghidra, and then when it was it used to be a wireworks, but now even that is computer graphics, and a computer just can do anything. And then he thought that the King Ghidra's the movement of a King Ghidra's neck.Was actually it looked more impossible in the computer.
まあこれからはそういうふうに映画どんどんデジタル化していくんでね、あんまりフィルムの時代を懐かしんでもしょうがないんですけれど、どうだろうな。だからこれから先どうなっていくか。わからないですね。もう映画はもう映画館で見る時代じゃなくて配信の時代になってくると、なんか20世紀の映画とは別の映画になっていくような気がします。
It's not just the computer that there movie is not even something that you have to go to movie theater and watch. That's you just can watch it at home and anytime you want and soHe doesn't know how that their movie world is going to change, but their, well, it's, and of course that that's how the world is changing. So it's nothing is same as before, but their he can really imagine how it's going to be, but their, well, that's they we all kind of have to accept it and that good or bad.
So very true. Mr. Omori, in closing, do you have any projects or any activities you want to let your fans know about that you're doing presently or in the future?
5年、6年ぐらい前に高一川北監督はまだ生きてらっしゃるときに大阪芸術大学、僕の大学に呼んで映像学科に特撮コースっていうのを作って、そしたら結構特撮が好きな日本の若い人たちがいることが分かって、結構特撮をやりたいっていうんでうちの大学に来てる学生が結構います。で、まあスタジオにミニチュアを並べて、それで怪獣の着ぐるみを作ったりして、まあ昔の怪獣映画、を作る事業なんかやってて、まあそういう意味でさっき言った20世紀の映画を若い人に伝える、今そういうポジションにで大学の先生をやってます。
He works at the Osaka?
大阪University of Arts.
Osaka University of Arts. Okay. When about 6 years ago or so, that when Mr. Kokira was still around, that he invited him, Mr. Kokita, to his university and created.That special effect course in the school. And then there he found out that there are actually a lot of young people who are interested in the special effect. And then so there that there, he is actually teaching that how that the special effect movies were made back in 20th century.Instead of doing the computer graphics and stuff like right now. And then so he is happy to be in that position that they're the students are making the movies in the 20th century way like back then instead of those the new way. And he is very having a good time that he is able to teach that his way back then that to young people.
Not the digital special effect or handmade analog
traditional
special effect.
Well, I think I can speak for Patrick and the entire Kaiju Masterclass team. We would all love to be your students if we had the opportunity. Mr. Omori, domo arigato gozaimasu. Thank you so very much for joining us with Kaiju Masterclass. It's been a wonderful conversation. We've learned so much. Thank you so much.
Arigato gozaimasu.
通訳大変でした。ご迷惑をおかけしました。大変ですね。
Thank you.
Translation.
Thank you. So, thank you for watching this segment of Kaiju Masterclass, and please stay tuned to our schedule. We have many, many other programs and interviews lined up for you. Take care.